All right, we're live here at the organic coffee, tea and drink place, Wildflower in Banff, Alberta. It is June 17th. I'm here with Billy Rice.
What's up, man?
My God. He's here at day four of the regular ride going southbound. And
well, I need to give him a head start.
Yeah, kidding. Billy is decided to go down. He's gone already up southbound to north. I mean, he's already gone northbound from Antelope Wells. Did you start right up in Antelope Wells?
Yeah.
Right at the border?
Yeah.
And then you headed all the way up, and he's here in Banff live. I can't believe it. Billy's right here. Okay, so you said you had some mechanicals. You did, what, 22 days on the way out?
Yeah, and some hours. So
okay.
I don't know what the official, yeah.
And then what were the mechanicals?
Broken XTR pedal. Which I changed
broken
out.
Broken pedal, that's what Craig had.
Last year.
Luckily it held
together, like it kept spinning, but it was definitely about to come apart.
Really? So bearings or something in the pedal,
yeah.
Eh?
Yeah, it came out. All the grease like came out.
So that's like crossing the streams maybe and the grind from the dust kicking up.
Yeah, I guess. The rear wheel day one, the rear wheel fell apart.
The rear wheel fell apart. I'm just looking at my bike like right there while, so the rear wheel
fell
apart.
Yeah, it was put together improperly by stands, actually. The spokes were too short, and they were over-tightened, and all the nipples started popping. And that wheel had probably 800 miles on it. I mean, I had ridden it. So I had it rebuilt.
Who could have ever thought?
So I had it rebuilt in at Gila Hike and Bike. They rebuilt it. But then as soon as they had it rebuilt, I started having rear hub problems. And it got to the point towards northern Montana where I would have this ritual of getting off the bike like every few hours, banging on the hub with a rock, and like looping it down, and then it would spin.
Holy!
It was terrible.
It was terrible.
So
I would have ripped my soul out after pushing for so long.
Well, it was frustrating because I felt good. I felt stronger like than last year. I mean, I felt like I could go and.
So you're on it mentally, physically. It's just
but
that
the rear
all
wheel
of a sudden
wouldn't
the rear spin. Was. Oh my God, that's like Craig. Craig said I was on it. I was riding with Wally, you know, we're having a good time. We were pushing it. It was a lot of effort.
Yes.
And then when you find out your bike breaks down, it's like...
It's so frustrating.
I mean, look how much we look up to our bikes. Eh? When we get in a bad accident, you get up and you brush yourself off, you're all cut up, you go, how's my bike?
Yeah.
You know?
It is. Part of you.
I got in an accident too, and the first thing I did when the fire department got there, it was like, oh my God.
Yeah. It is. So that was pretty frustrating, but I changed the wheels out in Eureka.
Okay.
So I'm on a new set of wheels. And so hopefully...
Now, was it stands? You got stands, no tubes or anything?
Well, I'm running tubeless, yeah. But it's, no, it's just...
Different, brand new set of rims.
Yeah. I called Scotty at Absolute Bikes, and I was like, save me and send me whatever you would ride, and he did.
Is Absolute Bike kind of sponsor you?
No. No, just, you know, they're down on the route.
Yeah.
Just terrific service down there. And he had already worked on the wheels. I mean, I stopped at every bike shop on the way.
So that's what I got to do is I got to get to learn where the bike shops are in each town.
Yeah.
They don't mark that on the map, eh?
They're on the map. Yeah, they're on the map.
Each bike shop?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
they're on there. Last year I didn't need them. You know, last year I didn't have really any mechanical problems. This year I need them. So,
that was wild.
Yeah, and so that's why I'm here this morning, just delayed a little bit, just to do some... Thankfully, some routine stuff, nothing really catastrophic.
Yeah, just a good tune-up.
Just some stuff that'll set me up, And then I'll be in Elkford tonight.
Well, you got good Jason at the Soul Ski Shop there.
Yeah.
He's really good.
Yeah.
They'll dial you in. He just told me, he says, yeah, Billy's got his bike in here already. And I was like, where's Billy? Hey, I got to talk to him, eh? How did your, what kind of bike do you have?
It's just a carbon fiber Marin, rigid.
Moran? Is there a model name? Carbon fiber Moran?
No, I think that there is for the stock bike, but I just needed the frame.
Okay.
Right, so I think all their carbon frames are the
just
same.
Pretty much the same?
Yeah.
It's 29er frame?
Yeah.
So you went 29er, that's good. In the front, your front shocks and everything held up, or is it rigid?
No, it's rigid.
Rigid?
Yeah, I changed shocks last year. That's no good.
No?
No.
Extra weight.
Well, yeah, you know, it's too much weight, and the shocks just don't hold up.
Yeah,
I destroyed it twice last year.
No kidding.
It froze
were they new shocks?
Yeah, Fox. Yeah, froze twice.
And Fox to boot. Yeah. So when everybody...
It can't handle
the vibration of the
dirt and the mud and the seals blow out. Yeah.
That really, they probably, when they make the shock, they don't...
They're not thinking about the Tour Divide.
Yeah, they're not. No. They should almost come out with a Tour Divide shock. You know what I mean?
Which would
like
just
endurance
be, which would be old school. You remember what was the bike company that had the big elastomers?
Oh.
You remember that?
Oh.
That's
going way back, but
that's it, though. What was it? Pro something? But that's the Tour Divide shock. That would have been
really good.
That'd be the one.
Very good point.
Yeah.
Very good point. Hey, hi, bud.
How did things work out for you?
Yeah, not too bad. Not too bad. I'm just doing an interview on camera, so yeah. Okay, so listen, I was gonna ask you something else. On your way up, how was the weather? Because I know when people say when they're trying for the record, you know, you land up hitting, like last year was really cold when everybody's going southbound. I was like, oh my god, and I was hearing it like, geez, all the swear words. It was a little bit chillier than normal. So coming up, this is a brand new year.
Yeah.
What was it like coming up?
So New Mexico was brutally hot. It was hotter than it was definitely in July than, you know, last year.
Yeah.
Which the rains come in and cool New Mexico down later. So it was hot.
Probably
it was
makes
real
it
hot.
Humid too. Like humid hot just like baked right through.
But no, New Mexico was really hot. Colorado and Wyoming were actually really nice. I mean, I really couldn't complain.
Really?
Once I hit Montana, started raining, got cold.
That's that mountain action with the water.
I went 3 or 4 days without seeing the sun. And that's that same time all those individual time trial guys were dropping.
ITT. Yeah.
Yeah, they, you know, most of them dropped out.
Yeah, they were.
And it was just
like
that
flies, actually.
Unrelenting cold rain.
Oh,
you know, it just never ends.
You're not,
never
you guys remember that, eh? Like, you guys that are newbies. I mean, and
you got to find a way to be happy in that.
You got to find a way to just like be able to make it through. Like, so what's your deal with how would you tell someone trying the tour to combat the cold when it starts to rain and you got your rain jacket on and you're getting chilly and you're shaking?
It's pretty simple, but you got to stay ahead. So, you know, make sure that your rain gear is on for one.
Yeah. Don't start riding the rain. Go, well, looks like it's not going to let
up.
For
me, don't get behind on your food. You gotta keep eating.
So don't push yourself for like a 180 mile stint and then go, wow, the bars.
If that weather comes in and you don't have food, you're gonna have problems.
Because you built
heat. Because you can't, yeah. And then keep riding. You gotta keep going.
Yeah, because I know myself out here, I never missed a storm. I haven't missed a storm for 15 years in this valley. And I know just from here that if I slow down, it takes 7 to 8 minutes for you to cool down, and then you got to hop on the bike.
Yeah, that's right.
And then it takes another whatever free person.
Yeah, you got to work it back up.
I mean, some people it takes a while to work it back up. You know, it just doesn't come right away.
Yeah.
But if you have that heat from some fat, like, I don't know, some people tell me sausage and cheese. Like, I know some guy brings a big, long brick of cheese and a big, long hunk of kielbasa, and he just straps it to his bike.
You got to keep eating.
And he goes, the fat is just good.
Yeah.
Do you get into the nuts at all?
You know, it's weird. I eat whatever I'm craving, and I crave different things on different parts of the route. Kind of based on altitude or temperature. I'm not really sure what.
I think it's just an intuitive thing with your body. Some days, like, you know, when they say you're pregnant, it's kind of like, geez, I'm craving pickles and milk. So,
and sometimes it's hard to predict. You know, if you hit a resupply, you know, I try to plan my cravings accordingly, but that can be difficult. So I never typically buy more of two of the same thing. Like, variety is real important when I'm doing a resupply.
So it just... shakes you up. What, do you just throw it in your front bag or something, or at the bottom?
No, so the bag, I use the middle bag. I have like a small top tube bag, and I fill that one with food.
Okay, and then you have small top tube bag and then two water bottles?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
I like to keep it really simple. I don't... You get tired, and you start... If your setup is too complicated, I'm like, hey...
Yeah. I know
you'll take off with a bag open and you'll lose stuff.
You were saying that. What was that all about? You left with the top tube bag open?
Oh, that happened last year. Yeah, I lost my arm warmers. Yeah, because my bag, my seat post bag, I forgot to close it and rode off.
Oh.
Yeah, that was...
And you're, because you're just in the zone. Do you find...
And you're exhausted. Yeah, you're tired.
When you're exhausted and you're tired, how long does that take before someone, like, who does the tour divide, when does it start to set in? The second day, 2 days of sleep, or that fourth day of no sleep, you're like, air.
You know, the guys who ride the route well, not even necessarily fastest, just the guys that are kind of doing it the cleanest, have really figured out their sleep, rest, eat, you know, cycle.
They have an idea.
Yeah, and they're able to manage that well. I didn't really manage that all that well last year, you know. I didn't get near enough sleep last year. I'm trying to do a little more sleep.
Was that your first time last year?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm trying to do a little more sleep. I'm doing way better on the food this year.
Are you?
Oh, yeah. This year, way better on food. I'm still working on dialing in sleep for the kind of the optimal performance. If you sleep too much, then you can't get the miles in. If you don't sleep enough, you can't get the miles in. So you're really looking for this...
little sweet spot.
It is a sweet spot, and that sweet spot changes based on your day.
So if you're hitting, like, Craig's gone through the mountains right now, I'm suspecting that he might choose at one point in time to just go a little bit up on his sleep to rest his legs, let his body recoup.
Yeah.
You got another set of, like, hills to come,
right.
So it's, you know, and then... I don't know, are you able to use your phone along the route to pull up, like, track leaders and kind of go, oh my god, there's that guy, he's right behind me.
You can, but I don't, so...
I guess there's not probably a lot of cell coverage along the way.
There's not a lot, it's real patchy. But the thing about that is, the Tour Divide is really a collection of individual time trials. I'm not really racing the guy next to me. I mean, I am, and I may be using his time trial to motivate my own. But the guys who are racing it well understand that they're racing their own time trial. I'll give you an example. If you look at day one on the Tour Divide, and you've got Craig and Mike taking off.
Yeah.
With this huge group of people following them and trying to keep up.
Yeah,
and
exactly.
My question is, is their goal 15 days? If it's not,
then you
let them go.
Exactly.
Because I'll tell you what, I saw everyone. I passed every blue dot.
Did you?
Oh, yeah.
How was that?
Craig and, I'll tell you, but Craig and Mike put a hurt on those guys.
Oh.
There was a 3-hour gap between Craig and Mike and the next ones. And I told 3 and 4, I'm like, hey, you guys are going to have to step it up. And I believe the comment was, no.
They just burned it.
Yeah, the other one that surprised me is Max Morris was in 25th place
when I went through.
And I thought I had missed him. You know, I wanted
He's a seasoned driver.
And he's totally seasoned and mature and kind of has it together.
Yeah.
And so we sat, you know, I found him finally. And, you know, and he had it. You know, he's got it nailed. He's like, my goal's not 15 days. My goal's 17. I did 170 miles yesterday, and I'll do it again today. Like,
there you go.
He's got it.
Yeah.
Right?
He's got his focal point, and I think a lot of people understand that to pretty much do road racing. If you're a road racer and you watch people, we just had the Banff Bike Fest just a little while ago.
Yeah.
Or a couple days ago. Yeah, that yesterday, that was all weekend. Anyhow, when the peloton gets to going, all of a sudden, three guys might break.
Yeah.
And, you know, two guys might break, teammates, and then another guy wants to get into the top three. One guy breaks win, and the other guy's supposed to break win. And the other guy switches to the front, and he breaks win. The other guy's trapped. Well, when you're doing 3,000 miles, you got to remember that the peloton behind isn't bolting to catch because they know, as a group doing their own speed,
right,
the front runners are going to, like, wind out eventually.
Right.
And if you're not doing your own race in the road race, you're just going to pucker out. So it's the same thing with here, but I think the excitement, and it's like even at the start when I was getting everybody to cheer, I hope you guys liked the start cheer. It was just crazy. I was telling everybody to give me a 1, 2, 3,
oh, God.
Yeah, and so you'll see it on the film. I just posted this morning when you get a chance. But, if you don't do your personal best, that's what I tell people. It's a testimony to the fact that you're here, that define who you are. Everybody else is sitting on a couch at home or going to the bar just drinking beer. Not that, you know, no offense to them, but I mean, some people have that habit of just going to the bar, going to the bar, going to the bar, going to the bar, going to the bar. And they don't get into, like, the nice things about how life can be on a bike. Going touring. I mean, you don't have to do the Tour Divide, but I mean, you can set it as a goal. You know, do short little stints of 100 miles and roll with a girlfriend. You know, make it part of your family to pass it on to your family. But wow, what you're doing, and it's, so what brought you back the second time? I asked pretty much all the riders on camera, what brought you back and what inspired you to actually try the Tour Divide?
Well, you know, last year I just fell in love with the round. I mean, it looks to me like there's several different kinds of riders out there, right? I mean, there's the kind that come out on the divide and drop almost immediately.
Yeah.
You have the ones that finish and never want to go back, right? Like, it's checked off their list. Good to go. I had a blast.
Thanks.
It was good. Yeah. You know, and then there's like this other group that becomes horribly addicted to that route.
Majorly.
I'm in that group for sure. And so I was, you know, just trying to think about re-racing it again. I live at 318 feet. There's no hills. Right? I mean, I just can't.
What place do you live?
In Texas. Yeah. Okay. I cannot train at the level of, you know, these guys who are able to do the 150, 160 group, you know? So I knew I wanted to come back. I knew I wanted to do it again. And then just kind of realized it had never been yo-yoed. There was no yo-yo time trial time published anywhere. So I figured, let's go lay it down and
let's give it
a go. You know, the original goal was to be here for the depart.
So let's tell the people out there, what does yo-yo mean?
So yo-yo just means back-to-back on the round.
Yeah,
so
a yo-yo goes up, and then it comes back down.
Yeah.
So you go northbound, and then come down.
Well, I chose to do it.
Or you can go southbound, and
sure.
Then go back north.
Yeah. And actually, Matthew Lee asked if I did it wrong, like if I should have done it the other way. And there's probably logistical wisdom in starting in Banff, going to Mexico, and going back to Banff.
That's what I'm thinking of doing. I think I got your email here,
right.
And I said, here comes my kids. Hey, hi, you guys. Tour Divide champions in the making.
There you go.
Wow. Any one of them can get out there and do it.
That's funny.
Wow, you're inspiring them without knowing.
Yeah,